throughout time. Black women have been sowing seeds of survival, wellness, and self-care into their daughters.
My mother worked till 12 o'clock at night in this ladies' room for tips to send me to school.
During the transatlantic slave trade, these tactics and skills were passed down, carried on, and gave us not only a will to live, but the means by which to do so.
We are sick and tired of being sick and tired.
Now in 2020, more than ever, we need to remember the ancient wisdom and daily rituals of our foremothers who prepared us for a time such as this. And so today, we call their names. Our mamas and their mamas and their mamas before them. Women who were never meant to survive but blazed through anyways.
I stand before you today as a candidate for the Democratic nomination for the presidency of the United States of America.
We are the harvest of these women. And with the Daughters of Campaign, we share their stories and self-care secrets to inspire a revolution and to wage a resistance movement for the total healing and liberation of our people.
Isn't it beautiful? All right.
Hello, everyone. Happy Friday. Happy Friday, Morgan.
Hey, happy Friday.
Hello happy to Friday. Everyone who's calling in from or viewing us, because we are live and coming direct from all over the country and the world. Morgan, where are you at this afternoon?
Akragana,
yes. And I'm Vanessa, and I am actually right across the street from Malcolm X Park in Washington, D.C. Excited to welcome everyone to our second Daughters of Broadcast. It's part of a series of conversations that GirlTrek, which is the largest health organization for Black women in the country. You may have seen us in your community reclaiming our streets, inspiring our daughters, embodying our bodies and healing ourselves wearing superhero blue. We unleashed this campaign last week to inspire a million Black women to call the names of our mamas and their mamas and their mamas before them. We promise you there would be a healing in the land. And I'm telling you, Morgan, there were more than 25,000 women who tuned in live from all over the country. It was a for the culture moment for sure. It set
Vanessa, the tone. Half a million people watched it. A half a million people watched it since Friday. Yeah, a half a million people watched it since Friday. So for sure, it was bigger than anybody ever dreamed. And, you know, it's funny, I put that, I was like, well, dreams really do come true. And then my sister in the comments was like, and prayers come true too. And I was like, dang, literal. But you know, she's
God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good.
Prayers and dreams, prayers and dreams. Somebody make that hashtag. Well, welcome everybody. My name's Morgan Dixon. This is my friend, Vanessa Garrison. We are two of how many? 600, 700,000 women who are part of the GirlTrek movement. And we're so, so grateful to have you today. So thank you for joining us. Today is an epic conversation. It is an epic conversation that I'm a little bit even nervous to have, because it's Black royalty, it is our legacy, it is every single one of us is implicated in this conversation. And I invite you to join us in making this very conversation be what happens tonight. This is epic, it is long coming, it is something that we've all been looking forward to for weeks now, but generations. It is the coming together of two dynasties, and I am super, super excited. Before we do the introduction, before we bring them on, I want you to tag your friends. Last week, we asked you to tag your friends, and in less than 10 minutes, we had 10,000 live viewers, and we promised that we would give $10,000 to the GirlTrek Emergency Relief Fund during COVID for women like many women who are out here today who are just trying to make a way. And congratulations, we did that. And not only did we do that, but we got match funding for this week. If we're able to get 10,000 in the first 10 minutes, then a generous donor, a woman from New York City, said she will put up 10,000 more for the GirlTrek Relief Fund. So please join us in tagging your friends. And this is a multi-generational conversation. So tagging your mothers, your aunts, your daughters, because this will be epic. So please join us in doing that.
No, it's so I just want to tell for everyone who's out there, Daughters Of was not a campaign that was about Mother's Day. And I want you to know that because we have an opportunity as Black women to do what we know has not been done for us and needs to be done. And that is to celebrate ourselves, to share the self-care secrets and survival tips that our mamas passed down for us, to be our own award ceremony, as Solange says. And that's what this series is about. So although it kicked off on Mother's Day weekend, we are going to be for the next couple of months really having powerful conversations because we believe, and I want y'all to hear this, because we know and believe that Black women have been here before, and that women like Coretta Scott King, women like Betty Shabazz, women like their daughters who are going to join us today, Dr. Bernice A. King and Ilyasah Shabazz, those women know what we need in order to survive these trying times. And I feel honored. I feel so proud of the GirlTrek team that we were a part of bringing this to the universe. So I got my tea ready, y'all. I had my wine last week, but this is a conversation that requires some good tea because we're about to lean into some good conversation, Morgan. They have been wanting to have this conversation for so long, and their families are so powerful, and there is so much respect due to what they have done for us as a people. And I'm just beyond. So Morgan, we are going to share a little bit about our guests, I think, before we bring them on, no?
Yeah, without further ado, let's introduce our two guests.
Hello, sister. How are you?
Hello. What an honor and a pleasure to be here. You girls are doing it. We are everything. I am so proud to be on the show. I'm happy.
Oh my goodness. Well, listen.
I'm so proud of you, young lady.
Yes.
Well, on behalf of 600,000 women, we just want to say thank you for making time. Listen, we'll get into it, but I done read your bios. You don't got time. So thank you for making the time to join all of us, ordinary women around the world, extraordinary women around the world. We are all ordinary and extraordinary in our own ways, sitting at our couches. I'm in my own living room. Comfortable, cannot wait to have this intimate conversation tonight. So thank you for making the time. Vanessa and I wanted to start with a cool segment. First of all,
question even before that segment. Did y'all watch last week? Did you watch Angela Davis and Nikki Giovanni? And do you have anything to say to the people about what happened last week?
Well, I was telling everyone how outstanding it was. Angela Davis, wow. Nikki Giovanni, wow. I am friends with each of them, and you know, they are always such an inspiration. And I think it's great that you guys provided a platform for these two soul sisters, these powerful two women, to inspire and uplift this new generation so they can see what we're all about.
Yes.
And I tried to watch, but unfortunately, I had some other things going on, so I didn't get a chance to really tune in the way I wanted to.
We got you on the replay. We are going to share the links out so that everyone who missed last week's conversation can tune in. And what is getting ready to happen tonight is definitely historic. So, yeah. So, Morgan, let's kick off our first segment because everybody at home, they have questions.
Yes. Can I say something before you all kick off? So back in 2010, I think it was, I spoke for this women's, I want to say women's business organization. And it was about 1,000 or so women in Atlanta at our World Congress Center. And before I delivered my message, a lot of times, you know, when I'm getting ready to speak, and while I'm speaking, the Holy Spirit will just drop something in my spirit. And as I stood before all of those women, the Holy Spirit just dropped this in my spirit. And I said to them in 2010 that this, you know how we talk about this is the decade of the woman, this is the year of the woman. I said, this is the century of the woman. And wow, have I seen it unfolding since that time. So thank you for what you all are doing.
Thank you for that.
We'll listen, accepted. All that blessing, all that call to action, accepted. Oh, it's so nice to see you both. You're so beautiful inside and out. I can't wait to have the conversation. We wanted to start with a segment called Black Royalty. And listen, we are very grateful to have a Black princess, but we've been done had some Black princesses. And I'm saying it's both of you. So we were like, we have so many questions to ask, like people from a royal family, people who have represented and taken us through the struggle. So let's start that segment right now.
Yes. Before we get into the serious questions, my first question, and this is for the both of you ladies, we want to know, when your mothers were cooking their favorite meal, I'm talking about for the family around the dinner table, what would they cook?
Bernice, you want to go first?
I can go first.
Okay, go ahead.
Unfortunately, because my father being assassinated at 5, it shifted a lot of things. When I was 5, it shifted a lot of things in our household. So I didn't get a chance to really experience my mother cooking on a regular basis. The few times that I can recall, though, that she did cook, she made a mean pot roast and it literally melted in your mouth.
Mm.
Yes.
That sounds
good. That was when I ate beef.
Right, because we don't eat meat now. But I know when I was growing up, my mother used to get pastrami. She would get it from this halal place and she would get lamb. And I loved lamb. I loved lamb so much. Lamb, and she would make these mashed cauliflower, and we grew up thinking they were mashed potatoes. And then the other thing she made that she was very famous for were these whole wheat dinner rolls that she made from scratch. And, you know, those are things that I can remember being really delicious, but she really did not, she was not the cook as we got older.
Look.
Oh my God, but somebody put it on the internet. That's what I'm saying. Somebody put it on Twitter. Yes,
Black women knew before everybody else knew.
Coretta Scott King invented all the meals. I'm saying, like, it needs to be a whole book. It's so good. Thank you both for that. So other questions people are just burning to know. Like, how did you decide what you were going to wear every day? You were in the public eye from birth. Like, how did you, were you able to pick your own clothes for school when you were like little?
Well, for my family, we all dressed alike. My mother had the three big ones dressed in the same dresses, and the three little ones were dressed in the same outfits. And there were these things, they were like garanimals, you know, and my sisters, my younger sisters especially, would wear their garanimals. You know, they were these Danskin kind of outfits. We always had like an ensemble on that my mother would dress us in. But my mother was very fashionable. I have to say that. You know, when I look at some of her pictures, you know, 60s, 70s that I have on my wall, I just thought she was the most beautiful person I'd ever laid my eyes on. And she was very, very fashionable, very fashion forward, you know, definitely into the fashion.
That's probably one of the reasons why she and my mother connected. That was the connection points. But for me, obviously as a little kid, my mom and we had babysitters. They kind of set aside my clothes, but as I got a little bit older, you know, I started choosing my own clothes. But as she said, we had fashionable moms. And so, you know, you kind of pick things up from watching your mom. And then I had an aunt who was extremely fashionable. To this day, she is 92 years of age. She's my father's sister. And from head to toe, the hat to the purse, she was matching, to the shoes. So I watched her growing up. I watched my mother growing up. And I kind of took some of my cues from them.
Oh, that's amazing. My last question for you in this segment is, if your mothers were putting on a song, I'm talking about the door is closed, the world is out, I either want to cut loose or let my hair down or dance a jig in the living room, like what was their go-to song or artist that they would put on? Like mine is Anita Baker. Like, okay, like just give me some Anita Baker, don't matter what the mood, like she's going to get me right. What would your mothers play?
Well, my mother had a radio show in New York, and the song that they used to start her show was, and to end it, was "I'm Every Woman" by Chaka Khan. But my mother also, like, we had a lot of musicians that would come to our house. There was a show called Soul, and Curtis Mayfield and Marvin Gaye, Miriam Makeba. You know, all of these people used to come. And so our house was definitely one with great music and six daughters.
Wow.
Well, of course, you know, my mom was her ambition was to be a concert singer. That was interrupted by my father, of course. But she loved classical music, opera music. And every morning we would hear her coming down the hall, kind of tuning up with me, 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 me. But I recall she loved Negro spirituals. And I had her actually sing at my ordination one of her favorite Negro spirituals, which was Ain't Got Time to Die. You know, Lord, I keep so busy working for the kingdom. Keep so busy working for the kingdom. Ain't got time to die. So that probably would be hers, because literally my mother was full force like every day until unfortunately a major stroke you know, debilitated her. But she was full force up until that point.
All right, let's talk about Ain't Got Time to Die, because I got so many questions. I got so many questions about the song, about our philosophy in life. Let's talk about it. Last, most important question here. Okay, what was it like to date? If you are Martin Luther King and Coretta Scott King's daughter, how do you date people? Like, do you bring people home? Like, what did your mom say when you brought, when was your first date, and did you bring her?
I was rebellious. Let me just say that I was super rebellious. Most people probably wouldn't believe this about me, but when I dated, and matter of fact, I tended to have very long relationships. This sounds weird, but I had a boyfriend at age 9. from 9 to 11. I know, go figure. Demetrius was his name. You know, we used to talk on the phone, and I would have to sneak and do that, of course, because my mother, you know, she wouldn't have had that. In high school, I dated someone, for those people that are from Atlanta, we had a lot of housing projects at one point, and I dated a guy from Bowen Homes. And you can imagine people thinking the daughter of Dr. King dating someone living in the housing projects. People probably expected I needed to, you know, date at another kind of what people call another level, even though I don't see people on levels. And so, you know, he was a football player and we're really well known around the school. And so there were times when she always told me, you know, don't, you know, you can't have company when I'm out of town because my mother traveled quite a bit. And I remember one time I just defied the rules. I had him come over to the house, but we sat outside on the porch. So I didn't go inside. So, you know, and then, it's, you know, she had a way of, pulling people close to her and asking questions. And she was very observant and very shrewd and very wise. I'm not sure, you know, I didn't always make the best choices that met her approval, but she was extremely cordial and nice to all of the guys that I dated.
Look, Dr. Bernice A. King, there is a bunch of Black women at home like, she just like us, thank God. She also had somebody sliding in her DMs, but it was just onto your porch. It's kind of the same thing.
No, I feel like telling. That's all I'm saying.
Ain't even an interview about us. We would like to know how was it dating being the daughter of Betty Shabazz and Malcolm X?
Oh my gosh. So we used to go, now remember, there's six of us. So there were times when boys would come to our house and my sisters and I would get, you know, we would look out the window and there would be one boy who would come to date my sister Kabila, who was a little older than me. And then me and the three little ones, you know, we would like tease them and everything. But we would go to our grandmother's house a lot. And my grandmother lived in Philadelphia. And so when we would go outside, my uncle's, you know, three of my mother's brothers, they would like terrorize any boys or guys that would come near us. And I remember going out with one boy in particular. We went to Robin Hood Dell Park and we went to a mall. And by the time I came back to my uncle's house, oh my gosh, my grandfather, all my uncles, everyone was out there and it was just really something. So it was a little difficult dating when we were younger because my, you know, they were just super, super overprotective. Very overprotective.
No, I love that. I love that story. And I love this whole segment because, and for everyone who's just maybe even just tuned in, we have an hour or so with you, and it's going to be a beautiful hour. I'm going to do a deep dive conversation with you, Ilyasah, and Morgan's going to talk to Dr. Bernice King. And then we're even going to give you two, we're going to step out of the equation, and you guys are going to have an epic, intimate conversation together. We're going to bring in some special guests for questions. Those questions and this history, it's real, it's serious, it's heavy. But I love the levity of Black women. I love that we, look, when I see pictures of both of your mothers, they were fly. And I'm like, man, yes, Black women show up in the midst of like pot trials and tribulations and we still parent and we still listen to music. So I loved hearing those stories about both of your mothers, just to frame them as real everyday Black women who just did extraordinary things every day. And so thank you for sharing that. Thank you for sharing that. So we're going to hop into our conversation. Ilyasah, are we ready for that, Morgan?
Yeah, sure. Let's go.
Okay. Oh, first of all, how are you doing? I was telling people earlier, first of all, I really do live right across the street from Malcolm X Park in DC, although the new natives call it something different, but it's Malcolm X Park to any Black folks in DC. You know, I've read everything about your father. I've seen all the documentaries and the movies, but this is a conversation about your mother. And this is a conversation about the lessons that she passed down to you. Because in this legacy of Malcolm X and Dr. Martin Luther King, there's something that we know as Black women, which is Your mothers weren't just behind the scenes, even raising families. They were organizers. They were strategists. They were women who then maintained the legacy after tragedy and did it excellently. And that is not something that is talked about enough. It's not something that's celebrated enough. And yet it is something that Black women everywhere experience in our daily lives. We experience our mothers show up as superheroes in really powerful ways. And that's what this Daughters of campaign is about. And the campaign is an opportunity for Black women to call our mother's name. So I have called mine as far back as you can go. I am Vanessa, the daughter of Annette, the daughter of Olympia, the daughter of Melvina, the daughter of Katie. I'm wondering, could you tell people who you are the daughter of to get us started with this conversation?
Yes, I'm Ilyasah. I'm the daughter of Betty. I am the daughter of Ali Mae. I am the daughter of Helen. I am the daughter of Matilda McAfee. I am the daughter of Louise Norton. I can keep going if you like.
Yes. Oh, no, I love that. Yes, please.
Yeah. No, you know, one thing, and is one of the reasons why I'm sure there are many viewers and supporters of GirlTrek, is it is so important that we do call on our ancestors, that we honor them, that we understand that we are here because of them, and that we have a responsibility to our ancestors and to our children for the benefit of future generations. And that is one of the things that I just admired so much about my mother. She fought really hard to protect and safeguard the legacy of her husband because it had absolutely been misappropriated. And she always said it wasn't so much so that her husband could shine, but it was for the benefit of future generations to realize his work, because it's extremely important. And it's the reason why many people are now turning to Malcolm X when we look at these outright injustices that continue to happen. We now understand what Malcolm was talking about, because everything he said, now that we put it in context, is true.
It is. It's very true. Thank you for even sharing that and setting that context. One of the things I have been noticing also about, and we're going to talk about this a little bit later in the show around like the documentaries and stuff that have come out, but as we're in this very moment right now, where we're in a global pandemic, and there's been a lot of conversation about grief in this country recently, and around the collective grief that we are feeling as we are in quarantine, as so many of our loved ones, especially Black folks, are dying, and we are grieving the loss of experiences, of touch, of so much. And when I can't think of anybody else who was an example of how to live through grief or how to get on the other side of grief than your mother was. And I'm wondering, what did she teach you and your other sisters about grief? And what did you learn from her about grief that's helping you through this moment right now?
Ooh, well, you know, well, first of all, I was teaching. I had a class, two classes of young students, and it helped us to become a lot closer. You know, I felt like I had to be responsible for them to make sure that they recognized the time allowed for us to sit still, to go inside of ourselves, to listen, you know, to look and see, and to come out, God willing, with emerging new individuals. When I think about my mother, you know, she often said, find the good and praise it. And so it was a matter of looking at the focusing on the good as opposed to anything less than, and what opportunities we can find for ourselves in the interim. And a very important lesson, one of the most important lessons that she taught me, is self-love. You know, she often said, well, she didn't really say it. She made you come to the understanding of the importance of it. But, you know, as women, my sisters and I, we learned about the significant contributions that women made to the world. We learned about the significant contributions that Islam made to the world. And we learned about the significant contributions that that Africa and the diaspora made to the world. So we grew up with a very healthy sense of ourselves, loving ourselves wholeheartedly, and not relying on anyone else to determine our self-worth, And when we see people who are being mistreated, that we step in and do something about it. So,
yes, you know, speaking of that self-love part, actually, I read an interview that you did maybe 2 years ago. I think it was on Shondaland, actually. And you were talking specifically about how you told your mother, you know, I love you. You are the most important thing to me. And she responded back, focus on yourself. And you were like, it was hard at the time for me to hear that from her. But there was a powerful lesson about self-love. Can you tell people why, how that made you feel and why she said that, and tell the lesson around self-love that your mom taught you?
Yeah. So I grew up worshiping the ground my mother walked on. I thought she was just the most beautiful person. I thought she was like God. And I remember saying to her, Mommy, you know, you're the most beautiful person in the whole wide world. I love you more than anything in the world. And so she turned to me and she said, dear heart. She said, dear heart, focus on yourself. And I thought, focus on myself, you know, no chocolate, no treat, no surprise. And, you know, I came to understand that she did not want me growing up relying on someone else to determine my worth, to determine my value. Focus on me. Find out who I am. Love me. Love all of me. And once you can love yourself and you can love, you know, your ancestry and your history, then it makes it so much easier to love others and to make a difference. It's important for me that my students and our young people understand the richness of their history, not just the part of being enslaved, but why we were enslaved and the thriving civilizations and all of these great things, that we really are queens. And so when we see ourselves today as the brand loyalists, as the trendsetters and you know, as entrepreneurs, all of these things that we are in the forefront, Black women, you know, it's a part of our ancestry, it's a part of our heritage. And so when we recognize all of that, it makes it easier to have this sisterhood that we have to value. And I also want to just shout out to my sisters, Daughters of the Movement. Had it not been for the sisterhood that we share, you know, I don't know how easy it would be for us to continue to go out and do the work and then come back home healthy and whole. Sisterhood is extremely, very, very important.
Yes, it is. And speaking of sisterhood, you wrote a children's book about your mom with the author Renee Watson, who actually Nikki Giovanni was talking about last week. And it's called Betty Before X. And you said that in writing that book, you went back and talked to a bunch of your mom's like friends and some family to learn about her. And I was intrigued by that because I was like, did you learn something from talking to them that you were like, wow, I wish I would have actually asked this to my mom? There's so many things like unspoken between mothers and daughters. And I wonder, did you discover something in that you wished you would have had an opportunity to talk to her about?
Yes, I think the minute that you lose your parent, you know, you say, my goodness, I wish I had, you know, a book that she wrote, you know, a story for me, to me. You know, that's a hard one. But I did speak to a lot of my mother's childhood friends, and one in particular who passed away not long after I finished the book. You know, she wanted to let me know. My mother grew up in the church. She grew up a Methodist, African Methodist, Episcopalian. And, you know, initially in the book, there was, yes, Lord, praise Jesus, and all of these things, because, you know, and she said, well, you know, when we were going to church as little girls, we didn't jump up and we didn't do all of those things. And one of the things I learned about protesting and marching is that they put on their finest Sunday clothes. They got dressed up to march. They took a lot of pride in that. I got to discover my mother's humanity, you know, where her compassion and care came from. And it made me realize why my father chose my mother as his bride and vice versa. They were very much similar in that they were both extremely compassionate, very empathetic, very loving, very kind. I would encourage anyone who has their parents still alive that you ask all of the questions that you would think of once they're no longer here, because it's inevitable.
Yeah. Yes. Ask all of the questions. That's a part of what this campaign is about, Daughters of. We can say the names, we can ask the questions, we can fill in the blanks and the holes and the gaps and the things that was in the family Bible that we no longer can find, so that we can piece together whole selves from, you know, our past and history. My final question to you is actually, the children's book Before Betty X, and when I was reading up on your mom, and it's mentioned in the book as well, when Betty is little, and this is based off your mom's story, she felt unwanted by her biological mother, and she eventually is given away to someone who can care for her. And that was powerful for me, because this whole campaign is about the celebration of Black motherhood, but there's also a lot of women who I want to acknowledge tuned in tonight, tuned into this campaign, whose relationship with their mothers are difficult and are challenging. And I was like, Betty Shabazz felt that way about her mom, and then she still became this amazing mother. It was powerful for me. And I'm wondering, what do you think that that influenced your mother and the way she raised you, the fact that she did have a difficult relationship with her mother and did feel unwanted by her?
You know, so her mother had her out of wedlock, and her mother was sent to the South to have her. And her mother's older sister actually raised my mother until she was about 6 years old, when her aunt Fannie Mae passed away. And the book is Betty Before X. So once Betty's mother, auntie passed away, she went to Detroit to live with her biological mother. And when she got there, she discovered that she had siblings, that her mother had a husband, and that there was this whole family. But that family did not, her mother found it difficult to mother her, and so she found another mother. And one of the things that my mother did is, in our adulthood, in the 1970s, my mother founded this organization called Young Mothers Educational Development, YMED, in Mount Vernon, New York. And it was for young girls who found themselves pregnant and rather be shunned or ridiculed by society or sent south to disrupt their education, they had a safe space to be educated. And further to that, she had the Westchester Daycare Council. And so that when these children were young, women were being in school and had their children, their babies, that they had a place where their children would be babysat. So where they could stay. And that just spoke so much to, you know, who Betty is. She's compassionate, she's thorough, she's, you know, I mean, just everything.
Thorough. And so I love that word, yeah. Thorough. Yes, I love that word. Compassionate, thorough, keep going.
Genuine, trustworthy, loving, kind, great sense of humor, you know, everything that I could ever want in a mother. And I'm so grateful to have experienced, you know, her kind of love and her kind of support and her kind of tutelage, guidance, direction. I'm grateful for that. And I think, you know, what it says is, if we have a strange relationship with our parent, there are other, you know, it takes a village to raise a child, that African proverb. Yeah. And so there are other people that we can look to for that tutelage.
Yes, that's a perfect way to transition to Morgan and Dr. Bernice. It takes a village. I was raised by my aunt and in a village of other women who loved on me. And it's a part of what has inspired me around this campaign. So I love learning that about your mother. And it's a really intimate look at her that I think will help us for the rest of this conversation. So thank you so much for sharing that. I don't know if you knew all those things about her, Morgan.
No, I was floored. It was so good. Thank you so much. It was so great. Yeah. I can't wait to talk more. It was so great. So let's jump into the next kind of unplugged segments with Daughters of Absolute Freedom Fighters. And I would like to welcome you again, Dr. King, Dr. Bernice King. I know your initials are B.A. King, which is genius, by the way. Whoever thought of that is genius. I would like to call you Dr. King. Is that okay?
If you'd like, but it's okay to call me Bernie.
Dr. B, how about that? Is that a good middle ground? Dr. B, listen, you heard it.
Let me tell you why real quick. I tell young people to do this now. When I looked up my name, and it was several years ago, I grew up without knowing the meaning of my name. When I was a kid, I was known as B-U-N-N-Y Bunny. The reason I didn't like Bernice is because it sounded like an old person's name. I didn't know any young person named Bernice. And somewhere around my mid to late 30s, I finally looked up the meaning of my name. And my name means bringer of victory. So I love my name. So that's what I said.
Bring the victory for tonight's interview, ma'am. Yes, bring the victory for all of us right now. Listen, victory is a good word to start on because I have a whole lot of questions I could ask you. We got so many from the audience. I was really struck by what you said earlier about your mother and the song she sang. And what is the song that I Ain't Got Time to Die, is it?
Lord, I keep so busy working for the kingdom, keep so busy working for the kingdom, keep so busy working for the kingdom, I ain't got time to die. For it takes all of my time to praise my Jesus, all of my time to praise my Lord. And if I don't praise him, the rock's going to cry out, glory and honor, ain't got time to die.
Yes, exactly that. Ma'am, with all due respect, that's the sentiment I feel every day, and it's a lot of pressure, okay? And I think everybody out there, the first 3-4 weeks of COVID, none of us knew how to sit down. We was more busy during COVID because we was like, listen, we got to save the community during this world crisis. World crisis.
So busy.
No, I'm claiming the victory. I'm claiming the victory. Dr. B, you told me to claim the victory. And I'm saying this. This is what I'm saying. When I was preparing for this interview, I read as much as I could about you. And every single paragraph had an incredible accomplishment. And it was scrolling. I mean, president of this, president of that, this, that. I mean, protest this, writing letters to, I mean, you were writing letters to Mike Brown and his family. You were writing letters to Trayvon Martin. I mean, you were arrested when you were a child with your mother. I'm just saying this. We are not all the daughters of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, and we are certainly not all the daughters of Coretta Scott King, but there is something about that pressure to be great for our people that I think we all have a little bit of. And I want to know the dangerous side of that pressure and that duty. And can you just talk to us about that? Because you are the one who has you have survived and you are victory. So can you just tell us about battling that pressure?
Yeah, I will. It's not been easy. I have my moments and my stages and my phases in battling that kind of pressure. I tell people all the time what has kept me sane has been my relationship with Jesus Christ and especially the Holy Spirit. I give him and I give the Holy Spirit credit for everything in my life because literally some of the things that I've had to process through in life have been very, very difficult. So it's my spirituality, it's my foundation there. It's my fight to learn how not to live a life where I don't trust. A lot of times when you're in the limelight, when you're on those pedestals, you don't know who to trust, especially, and I'm sure Ilyasah can identify with this, especially when you had a father that was assassinated, especially when your family has been bugged by the FBI. In fact, when my mother died, an article came out in the paper, in the AJC, that said they ended the surveillance of Coretta Scott King when she's deceased. That was just a crazy article. You know, when you know your family in some form or fashion is being surveilled, when you know people have these extremely high expectations and they're constantly comparing you to your, in my case, just my parents. You know, some people may have a famous father, or they may have a famous mother, but we had famous parents. It almost drove me crazy. But I will say one thing that my mother helped me with to combine with my strong spirituality is she used to tell us growing up, you don't have to be me. You don't have to be your father. Just be your best self. And those words just resonate. They're always there at the forefront of my mind. When I get to those really low places, I hear a saying, just be your best self. You don't have to be your daddy. I don't care what people may have said on social media and in news articles about you and you not, you know, whatever, your father and all that kind of stuff. Just be your best self. So that's been my saving grace. And then, as I said, learning to trust so that I have places that I can be me and share the raw me. I have friends that I thank God for, that I'm able to just let it out and I don't have to be perfect. And that's so important. You don't, and I'm a perfectionist, just the way I developed. I'm a perfectionist. And I'm slowly at age 57 learning that I don't have to be perfect. It's taken a long time to get to this place, but learning I don't have to be perfect. I don't have to say the right thing. I don't have to be profound, because that's the hardest part. The hardest part many times is because God has, you know, gifted me in many ways. When it comes to the words that come out of my mouth, and I don't take that lightly, but because of it, I'm very careful sometimes when I'm speaking and I'm talking, and you know, it's an enormous amount of pressure. But now I understand that I don't have to be perfect in it. If I can just be my best self, if I can just be authentic and real. And if I can be okay with sometimes saying, I don't know, whatever you're looking for from me, I don't know. I don't have the answer. You know, I don't have the deep and profound thing like my father, because that's been an enormous burden. And I will say, a lot of times when people ask me, what are you grateful for? Or like when we've had New Year's Eve celebrations in smaller settings, they'd say, you know, what are you thankful for? I would immediately say my sanity.
Yes.
Sanity.
Can we talk about
it? Especially today.
Pardon me.
There's
for
a lot
second.
Of. Yeah.
Can we maybe talk about that, please, for a second? Because you've been so candid and honest about mental health. And it was surprising to me when I was reading about it, because I've been because I want Black women to talk about mental health. And I have been trying to talk about it even with myself in the quiet of my own mind. And you talk about a moment when you were 17 years old, and you use the word that you had a breakdown. You saw a documentary where that was about your father's life and about his violent murder. And you had seen it before, but for some reason at 17, it hit you for real, and that you had a breakdown. And you also talk a lot about carrying anger and holding on to anger. And we know about that. And I want you to know that you already know, but you are not alone. And that I have a lot of anger and rage as well. And so do people out here. And you just said something that I want to connect with that. You just said that you are able, when you get to your darkest places, you're able to pull yourself out. Can you walk me through what that, because last week I had a dark, I mean, it's hard out here right yes. now. So could you talk to the women who might today be experiencing a dark moment and tell them a prescription for how you get yourself out of it?
So actually, I was 16. Just so you have the actual facts on that, and it was the first time I really grieved the assassination of my father. And by that time, I had lost my uncle, who a year and a couple of months after my father was assassinated was found in his swimming pool. He didn't drown. We believe he knew something about my father's assassination, and so. We believe he was killed mysteriously too. My grandmother was shot in church when I was 11 years old. So by the time I was 16, all of this was inside of me. And I see this film, and immediately afterwards, I was very angry at God. I was very angry at my father. I was angry at white people. I was angry at black people. I was just angry. And I had decided at that time I was going to leave the church, even though I was in my mama's house, and you know, I couldn't physically leave, but internally I was leaving. And it was a year later when I got my call into ministry at 17. And my mother said I wrote something, but I haven't seen it to this day. Maybe it'll appear one day. I don't know what I wrote, but I shared with her about this call to ministry that I had, like, you know, that I heard a voice that I was going to preach like my father. But I ran for 8 years. I ran, one, because I was angry. I ran, two, because I was 17 and a teenager, and I wanted to finish being a teenager. I was drinking at the time, and I saw ministry as something very serious. I didn't see any women preaching at that time. There was one woman in our church who was 40. She was preaching because my grandfather was very progressive. But that anger has traveled with me all my life, and got to the place where I started hating. I started hating especially white people and white men in particular. And God used little simple stuff along the way to help me. There was a show that I was on once talking about my father's assassination with a white gentleman who happens to be a minister, evangelical minister. And this was in 2000. So you can see I was carrying this for a long time. This was in 2000. And although I was interfacing with, had grown up with white people, had uncles that I called, that were white that I called uncle, a white gentleman that I called uncle growing up. But I was covering all of this up. And this white gentleman on this show interviewed me, and he, in the middle of it, we were talking about my dad and the loss of my dad. He said, "Can I give you a hug?" Now, internally, I was like, "Hell no." but I you know, my mother taught me better. He reached out and he hugged me. And I will tell you, it was one of the most genuine hugs I had ever received in my life. And it just started some healing inside of me, and healing me from the hate that I had for white people. And on this journey, I've just discovered, because I used to have a lot of stomach problems. And, you know, a lot of it had to do with all of the emotion that I was holding inside of me. And we have to understand, you know, these emotions that we have can affect our bodies. They can weaken our immune system. And so we have to learn to find ways to process through the emotions. We're going to have them. But I always tell people, when you have these kind of emotions and these dark moments with these emotions, don't make a residence. Don't live there. Visit there, but don't stay there. Don't set up a home there, because it can be very dangerous. I had a point in my life while I was in law school and theology school at the same time. I have a joint degree, a master of divinity and a doctorate of law. I did a five-year program at Emory. And my first year, I ended up on probation. And the second year, they told me before I started that if I didn't come off of probation, they were going to kick me out of the school. So I went home, got a knife, and trying to figure out how to take my life at that particular point. And the Holy Spirit reminded me, you know, I said, "Put the knife down. You have a call on your life." And that's literally what saved me in that moment. So you really do have to have a strong spirituality. You know, for me, it's Jesus Christ and the presence of the Holy Spirit. And I gave myself permission when I first gave my life to Christ, truly gave my life to Christ, right before I preached my first sermon. I said, I told Jesus, "I want to be like you." And you have to be careful what you ask for. Because I asked for that, literally, when I get to these moments, he brings me close to him and he allows me to experience the suffering and yet the victory that he experienced. And so it enables me to kind of bounce back through the process. And as I do that, I talk about it. I talk through my emotions with people. It's nothing wrong. And I want to say this loud and clear, because so often in the Black community, we feel like if we see a counselor, if we see a psychologist, it means we're crazy and we don't have it together. No, if you don't, you don't have it together. It is necessary and essential. I've been through counseling with people. I've had opportunities to, as I said, share with very close friends and process through things. Therapy is very important. Self-care in these moments, you know, when you get to this place called anger, the reason why it is important that you talk through your feeling is because if you don't, you end up at rage, and then rage acts out. And oftentimes we will strike out against people closest to us. And I've done that over and over again. I love these people. I had to learn how to pull myself back and say, wait a minute, let me process through the motion. Yes, I experienced the anger. Yes, the anger is real. But I don't want the anger to overtake me so much that I can't be effective. And that's what it does. That's the danger even of hate. You know, I forget the person who talks about hate is drinking, you know, poison, expecting the other person to die. And so it does poison your soul. It poisons your spirit. It makes you sick. It weakens many of your cells and your organs. And so what I say to everybody, if you journal, journal. I don't journal, unfortunately, but I do talk, and I'm real. If I'm angry, I'm not going to say I'm not angry. I'm going to say I am angry. And I'm going to talk about it, because if I don't talk about it and I hold it in, you know, it just bubbles up. And as I said, it mutates and it becomes something else, and it's harmful to me. And I learned that. And so now I don't let anger just, you know, I don't let it sit there. I don't let it marinate. I deal with it. I confront it, you know, because I have to.
Well, you just helped so many people. So thank you for sharing that and being so vulnerable. And I'm being told to wrap it up, but I have one final question. Maybe we have 30 seconds, but it's so important for people. You have as much time as you want, but I'm just saying, let me hurry up and ask this question. There is a famous picture of you with your mother, and I didn't want to show it because it's at your father's funeral. And it's when you were a baby girl, and it's the most precious, iconic, beautiful picture of your mother, like holding and comforting you. So many mothers are trying to comfort their sons now in the era of being shown kind of gratuitous violence and murders on social media. And I wonder, like, how did your mother protect you from that kind of violence? And how can single mothers out there now protect their girls and boys from this kind of violence as children? What are the pieces of advice you might give to mothers?
You know, it's more difficult today because of social media. You know, people have more access to the visual, the videos. And so my mother didn't have to worry about that. She could keep me away from those things. But you know, it's okay to not feel that your children have to be so tied to social media and so tied to all of these different technology devices. We have to set boundaries with our kids because there's so much that is out there. And so I would say, you know, limit some of that and have real conversations. You know, my mother, when we, obviously at a little age, she couldn't have so much of a conversation with me. But as we grew older, she would have conversations with us. And always hold your kids. You know, there's something to be said about a hug. That's what I miss right now with the sheltering in and all this physical distance. I don't want to call it social distance, physical distance. You know, being able to hug people, to feel people's energy, and a mother's love transfer. That hug can be so powerful, and it has to be constant. But we got to protect them from the visuals, because that is so damaging to your psyche.
Thank you so much, Dr. King. I've learned so much. Thank you so much. So we're going to welcome back our other two friends. Thank you.
That was so beautiful. It really was. I actually feel it's appropriate at this stage just to call the name of Breonna Taylor. She was the Black young woman who was killed in Louisville as the police were executing a no warrant raid. And I just want to call her name in this moment, because as you were talking, I was like, yeah, like, we have to protect our sons. We have to protect our daughters. Like, COVID-19 needed to get in line behind all the things we already was dealing with as Black folks that was coming for us. And so just thank you. Thank you to both of you. This is actually a perfect transition into the next segment. And folks, y'all need to lean in for this, because Morgan and I are going to step out of the way. There are so many misconceptions. There are so many untruths. There are so many rumors. I mean, literally, it's like were they feuding? Were they enemies? Or were they friends? And this is an opportunity for us to, in sacred space and safe space of Black women on the internet, have a conversation. And we actually have a few photos, Morgan and I, where we're just going to bring them up and have you respond to those photos. And then just share your thoughts on them. And then we're going to move into just the two of you on the screen, just having a conversation. And I heard the two of you prior to this, by the way, going back and forth around. It's just a conversation between the two of you so that you can set the record straight yourself. So let's start that segment, Morgan.
Yes. So we want to debunk some myths. Here's the first picture. Can you please respond to this picture for us?
I think that was just a blessing in time that they had the opportunity to meet one another. Every time I see that picture, I'm grateful that that was a wonderful moment in history for each of them.
And it was a powerful moment of intersection in a movement. And I think that was close, Ilyasah, I think that was close to the time, either right before or right after your father came back from Mecca. The amazing thing about that photo is that they're both smiling, and they were carrying an enormous burden. You know, and for the photographer to capture that, because they were dealing with serious issues, a struggle, liberation of our people and humanity, because we had to liberate white people, and we still have to. It's an ongoing struggle. From all that's in their heart and all that's in their collective psyche and all that, you know, is in their collective history as well. Look at there.
I'm so grateful, Bernice, mm-hmm. that they had a sisterhood. Along with Merle Evers Williams, I'm so grateful that they had that sisterhood, because it is extremely important. You know, that they could lean on one another. They knew they could trust one another 100%. They both endured and experienced the same kinds of challenges and traumas. But in spite of that, they rose up and they had one. Right.
And they had each other. And they could probably look at each other without saying a word and know what the other was saying or feeling. Because of the similar struggle, the similar issues. And I didn't get a chance to tell you this before, but when your mother passed, it really affected my mother. Because, you know, her and a lot of times when I talk about this, I get kind of teary-eyed, you know. My mother... Maybe your mother as well, you know, they had moments of loneliness, and obviously probably felt alone at times. And I could feel some of that pain in my mother's life, even though I never talked about it with her. I just kind of carried it. And I always wanted my mother to have a place where she could just let down and be herself and not have to be Coretta Scott King. And the friendship that she had with your mother was that. It was a refuge. It was like you said, it was that sisterhood. It was the place where she didn't have to put on any public face. Not that she was pretentious, but you know, the pressure of being in the public like they were. And they could just be themselves.
The pressure of being criticized.
Yes. And she said, your mom, they would just giggle. They love to giggle. And so to have that kind of laughter in their life was just so refreshing. And so when your mother was no longer in her life, I saw the sadness. And she carried it. In fact, one day I said, Mom, I said, you're going to live a long life. And this is right after your mother died, because she had been really thinking about, you know, the tragedy and all. She said, well, I don't know. You know, look what happened with Betty. I mean, she was really carrying it. So she had a very special place in my mother's life and my mother's heart. My mother was very close to her sister, but I would say that she, during that time that they had their friendship, I think she became a best friend to my mom.
You know, a lot of these pictures that I have on my wall here in my office are pictures, two of the pictures that your mom gave to me of her and my mother. And, you know, she always signed it, Love, Aunt Coretta. And when my sisters and I would, you know, were having our feuds, she would always call us and, you know, put us back on the right path, because our mother wasn't here. So if there was one person that was very important to my sisters and me, it was your mother, as I told you so many times. And when I wrote my first book, she met me, I don't remember where we were. I think in that organization we were, and she had boxes of my book that she wanted me to sign so she could give away to friends. You probably still have those books.
They probably were somewhere. But she was so kind. She was so thoughtful. She did that. She would always support. She bought everything that Maya Angelou had at Hallmark. Everything. We still have some of those gifts. She was just so supportive like that. And she saw you all as her daughters. She felt a responsibility to bring you all close when your mother died. And she shared that with us. And I know she constantly was checking on you all. Because she was a very compassionate person. Wow. We have very special moms, huh?
Yes.
And
yes, we did.
So the next.
When I see this picture,
photo is there are two films that are recently released about both of your fathers, and we just want to know, like, if you've seen them, if you recommend them, if you think, what did they get right? What did they get wrong? And we can talk about it quickly, because we'd rather just continue hearing you talk, actually. You are wonderful. But both Who Killed Malcolm X and Malcolm in the, or Martin in the Wilderness were two documentaries that just came out that we thought we'd get your opinion on if you thought everyone should watch them or not.
Well, I could say Who Killed Malcolm X, there are a lot of people who discovered, you know, this generation of young people who discovered Malcolm, and even the previous generations that were misinformed on who my father was. I think they discovered a lot more about my father, his sincerity, his integrity, his compassion, his willingness to sacrifice his life for us. The one thing that I would have liked to have seen is, why was he killed? And what organizations were responsible in killing him? What organizations were responsible, and why was he killed?
Thank you.
Because history books have it that he was killed by his own people, and you know, the story is so much bigger than that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And for me, I hate you all asking me this question. I'll tell you. I'm trying to think about the best way to say this. I would say, watch it with the knowledge that everything in the piece is not true. And that's as much as I'll say about that. Because I want to respect everyone that was in that took part of it. But for the most part, 75-80% is true. But I want to just highlight the same thing that Ilyasah just said, because our family did an investigation into our father's assassination in 1998 and 99. And we discovered through our own civil trial that we had that there was a conspiracy, obviously a conspiracy that involved the highest office of the land down to the mafia. In our father's assassination. And I know that's difficult for some people to swallow. And so we've kind of, in many regards, kind of put to bed for us the who. We know James L. Ray didn't do it, that there is a bigger story, as Ilyasah said. And the commonality of who killed Martin, Malcolm, even Kennedy's and Megger is what we have to discover, because it's a similar foundation.
Wow.
Yeah. All right. So we're going to transition. If there's any other things you both want to talk about or clear up or teach us, please do that. And we'll excuse ourselves. And then the next segment and the final segment will be the audience. We're asking questions from the audience. We'll have some special guests join us. So please stay tuned.
Yeah.
So Ilya, I want to ask you a question or have this conversation with you, because we've never had it. I really don't like when people compare and contrast our fathers. Everybody has their own calling in life, own assignment. And a lot of times they speak about the violence versus the nonviolence, the contrast, etc. And this is the way I usually respond with regard to your father. And if I'm wrong, you can correct me. Number one, I tell people that, yes, my father believed that self-defense was a person's prerogative, basically. For him, he chose not to have arms, but he came to that in the early parts of the movement. And so although he believed the other people have the right to defend themselves by having guns, because this always comes up in our training. And I always tell people, my father's emphasis was on a movement and how he felt that violence would not get you to the ultimate goal of true freedom and true peace. And so what I always say to people when they say Malcolm versus Martin, or they say, we're gonna go to Malcolm route, as if they're saying, we're gonna go to violent route, because King was nonviolent. I always say, but what's interesting to me, although you all say that about Malcolm, there's never been on record that I even know of one incident of Malcolm being violent.
No, but he had a profound reaction. And so what he said is, if you are going to continue to put dogs, sick dogs on our children and nonviolent marching of protesters and so forth, and you are going to continue to extinguish fire hoses that rip off the skin of human bodies, then yes, we are going to defend ourselves. He did not see anything being solved by allowing police or any kind of brutality, bigotry, all of those things. He said, if you put a knife in my back 9 inches and you pull it out, or you put a knife in my back 12 inches and pull it out 9, the knife is still in my back. We need to sit down and have a discussion, right? A discussion about these horrific, terroristic acts that continue to happen.
Right. So that's where the contrast is. The contrast I'm saying, but the contrast is my father felt that nonviolence, what we call it, the principle that a lot of people can't understand or get, but voluntary or unearned suffering is redemptive. That by allowing yourself to experience this with power, your spirit has to be a part of this. This is not just laying out and letting people do something to you. Your spirit has a resolve that I am suffering for a greater cause. And I believe, kind of like when Jesus went to the cross, there is going to be redemption and there's going to be ultimate healing, etc. And so that's what the nonviolent philosophy believes. And that's hard for people, and I get it. But if the goal is reconciliation, as we believe, violence creates more violence. It's a descending spiral. So even though I defend myself and I attack the person back, eventually.
But my father never said that. He didn't say attack them back. He said, we need to put an end to this, right? And so when you think about it, when you think of people who are bombing cities, towns, individuals, how do you get that to end? Right? How do you get that to end? He talked about education. He talked about several things. But he also said, as long as someone is going to continually beat me upside my head, kill my children, my wife, you know, all of these things, something has to be done about it. And he didn't believe that just turning the other cheek was the answer. And I know that's not what your father said, to just turn the other cheek. Because even today, right, we have to create a safe space for our children to properly develop, right, without fear and trauma. And so we have to figure this thing out.
I wouldn't say without fear. They need to know how to channel the fear. The fear can't overwhelm them and overtake them. Because, see, a lot of things, you can have fear and courage at the same time. And a lot of people don't realize that. Just because you have fear doesn't mean you can go. You can't go and do something. You're just doing it while the fear is the emotion that's present in you, and you push through it. But I agree with you. You have to have a safe space. But I will say that in the end, I know just personally that a violent pathway, even a reactive violent pathway, for me personally, is not the way.
Yeah, but that's not who Malcolm was. Just want to be clear. That's not who my father was.
I got you on that. So for people listening, nonviolence is not weak. It's not passive. It does resist. It just refuses to be the inflictor in the end. And that, again, that's hard for most people. Because you believe in the end that what you're doing is going to expose the evilness and the ugliness of what that person is doing. Now, if somebody comes in somebody's home, I'm dealing with a movement versus somebody's home. You know, I personally don't feel that I need a gun because at the end of the day, you know, I'm going to go and a gun, you know, somebody put a gun on my father once in the South. And Bob Green tells this story, who was with him, and Andy Young was with him. The guy came up and said, Dr. King, I ought to kill you. And he had a gun in my father's face. And my father looked at him and said, you know, I love you, God, and I'm going to pray for you. And when he left, the folks in the car with my dad said, Dr. King, you don't need to be having your hand hanging out the window like that. You could get killed. He said, John Kennedy had the Army, the Air Force, the Marine, the Navy, the CIA, the FBI, the Secret Service, and they still got him.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, whoa.
So I think what at the end of the day, what both of our parents wanted was to make sure that our educational curriculum for our children was accurate, with accurate information, right? So that they could properly develop and grow with, And so I think that is really the ultimate goal, to make sure that our educational curriculum is inclusive of accurate historical facts. Let our children know who they were prior to Christopher Columbus. Let our children understand the significant contributions that were made to the world, that were made to this country by people in the African diaspora, by the indigenous people. You know, let us know the truths. And that is what my father was talking about, the importance of education, the importance of truth and justice.
Right, and guess what? Thank God. And thank God for this generation that will not let us go back to sleep. You know, since 2014, there's been a generation that has arisen, and they are determined that we're not going to be pushing this stuff under the rug anymore. And I thank God for them.
Yes.
Yes.
You know, Bernice, I also want to use this time to say, you know, I'm grateful. Bernice just was the treat for my two classes. My two classes just ended on Wednesday, and she was there, and she spoke to them, and it was just a wonderful way to end the semester. And I'm so grateful to you, my dear, darling friend.
Thank you. I appreciate you inviting me.
Absolutely.
Are we back?
Yeah, thank you so much for letting us listen in on that conversation. There's been so much said and written about those two philosophies, and to hear you both articulate it with such passion from your points of views, it was just really powerful. And it just, you know, we live in a world where I feel like it isn't black and white. There is this area of like just understanding a person's point of view. And I think if nothing else, people got understanding. And I do want to thank the new generation, by the way, and in this moment, actually, even the thousands of GirlTrek organizers who, in the legacy of Malcolm and Martin and Coretta and Betty, take to the streets every day and organize on behalf of this community, because when we tell the stories, people are inspired. So this segment has been beautiful, but there are some burning questions that we have from some women across the country. And look, we got some of your faves who are coming in to ask these questions. So I do want to say that the community has come through. This is going to be a For the Culture moment when these questions come. So let's actually turn this over to the people's interview. Right now, we're going to turn to the people's interview. And up first, we have a woman who I dearly respect. And I know Morgan dearly respects her as well. Morgan, do you want to say anything about Alicia? I mean, she's just so powerful and a perfect third to conversation.
Yeah, I was going to say thank you for that discourse. I think there's not a lot of spaces even where we can even have differences of opinions or like different perspectives on the same opinion. And I just appreciate it. I just appreciate your honesty and fire. So thank you for that. So the next generation is summed up in one woman, and her name is Ilyasah Shabazz, and she's one of the co-founders of the Black Lives Matters movement, and she is in, coming to ask a question. Hey, Ilyasah.
Hello, beloveds. How are you? It's wonderful to have gotten to listen in on this conversation. What an absolute treat. I wanted to start with a question that you all both actually answered, which really was about clarifying the assumptions about the legacies of both of your fathers. But you addressed that, and so I thought it would be helpful to come at the question from a different perspective. So much of what we learn about the work of King and the work of Malcolm X is, you know, not only rooted in a lot of stereotypes, but it's also very much rooted in a version of our movements and the world that unfortunately centers men at the expense of all of the rest of who our communities are. And this isn't to say that the conditions of Black men should not be paid attention to, but it is also so critical to lift up the ways in which the advocacy, the thought, the theories that both of your fathers gave us as a gift to better understand what struggle and liberation actually looked like really did center women. In the case of Dr. King, I recently, learned that Dr. King was an advocate for women's rights, and in particular for reproductive rights and reproductive justice. And of course, in relationship to Brother Malcolm, you know, he talked a lot about the ways in which Black women were the most disrespected people in America. And so I'm wondering if there's anything that you both can offer us as to powerful, powerful women in your own right, about what your family's legacies and the present has to offer those of us who have been holding up these organizations and been holding up these movements forever. And somehow the contributions that we offer are often distorted. And so I'm wondering if there's anything that you can offer, you know, sisters in this movement who are both holding the tension of what is happening to men in our communities, and also holding the tension of the lack of visibility of what is happening to women in our communities. And I think Breonna Taylor is a wonderful example of that.
So what I'd like to say is, you know, it's really unfortunate. First, it's such an honor and pleasure to see you. And thank you for your question. One of the things that happens is, you know, there are always these divisive tactics, right? When we think of Booker T. Washington, and I talk about this often, Booker T. Washington and W.E.B. Du Bois, you know, we're taught to choose one over the other instead of being grateful for the contribution, significant contribution each made with all of the trauma around us, right? Same thing with Tupac and Biggie Smalls, right? But when you have George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, oh, look at these great men. One never told a lie. One, you know, helped write, you know. But when it comes to our men, we have to choose one over the other instead of recognizing their significant sacrifice and contribution, right? In spite of the terrorism that we have endured and come and shine out of, right? That these two men took the time to sacrifice their lives and stand truth to power head on and say to us, you don't need to be afraid. You don't need to be afraid of them. They're bullying you. And why are they bullying you? What are they trying to take from you? Why are they incarcerating our young people? Right? So just, there's so many things. And I could get a little passionate, sister. And we understand that because we love hard. We love hard. And you know, I know my sister, Dr. Bernice King, you know, we love so hard. And it's very difficult to see these things still happening, you know. And at some right. point, we do have to come together and lead this thing and create strategies and make sure we come together, love ourselves, create strategies on how we're going to move forward and get this boot off of our neck.
Exactly. And yeah, Ilyasah, thank you for you and your work and the work that you and others have done to lead this new awakening in America that has been so desperately needed and overdue. So thank you and God bless you for that. You know, I want to say something just adding to what you said, Ilyasah, earlier when we were talking. You know, I said that we, you know, people have different assignments in life. It doesn't mean one is right or wrong. It's all a part of the human experience. And all of us come at this from different directions, from different stories, you know, different journeys, etc. But there's a common destiny that all of us desire, no matter where we come from. And if we can find a way, as my father did when he studied to prepare himself in life, it just ended up becoming a movement eventually. But then when he was in theology school, when he was studying in graduate school, he found a way, what he called to find threads of truth amongst all and weaving that into a whole. And I think we have to do that in our struggle, because oftentimes we pick sides. You know, I'm with this. It's nothing new. I mean, in the Christian faith, it was folks, you know, Apollos, Paul, you know, whoever you with. It's not about who you're with. It's like, what are you with? You know, Are you with freedom? Are you with justice? Are you with peace? Are you with equity? Are you with what's right? And get out of this whole notion of, you know, I'm getting behind this person. I'm getting behind this person. Because that is the death of our community. And they've done it. Age old trick. Divide and conquer. That's what we have to overcome, Ilyasah.
Yes, that's right, my love.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. And thank you so much, Alicia. We're going to move to a question from the audience. And the question that I have is from a woman named Mona. Let me get her name right. Moni Law. And Moni Law asks what you think about Black women running for political office.
Wonderful. Awesome.
Absolutely.
I mean, sure. You know, I said it earlier, it's the century of the woman. Yeah. You know, obviously there are people, you know, who have, you know, bad intentions, even women. But I think wholeheartedly that the more women that we elect to office, we have a greater chance of creating a more compassionate nation and world. That's what I believe.
That's right.
Because we bring so much nurturing, we bring so much understanding of community and family and connection. I think we're great strategists. When you think about the movement that my father led, there, you know, my father didn't start a boycott. The men didn't start the boycott. It was the women who had the idea all along. They were trying to find the right point at which it needed to be done. And it was the Women's Political Council who did that. There were women at those strategy tables. And we can't forget that. And we have to lift that up. So yes, we need to run for political office, and we need to run for all, from the highest political office of the land down to our Board of Education.
I have one quick question from a viewer. Her name is Shonda from LA, and she said, could you guys share one quick self-care practice that each of you have? What do you personally do, your favorite self-care practice? How do you take care of yourself?
You know, I focus a lot on, I guess on the health and wellness side. I do a lot of research in terms of what things that I need to make sure that I'm taking to supplement with my regular diet. I don't think people realize that as you continue to get older in particular, there are things in your body that begin to diminish and deplete as you age, and you have to really supplement in order to be able to resist certain things. Even in this coronavirus time period, there are things that our body needs to build our immune system that we just don't have. And so I encourage people to really to do that research so that they know those things. So I'm doing things like that. And as I said, for my mental health, I allow myself to experience moments. I've had a couple of three breakdowns during coronavirus, but I brought myself back through it. So, yeah.
What about you, Ilyasah? What do you do for self-care?
What do I do? You know, I think because I come from a family of a lot of sisters, the sisterhood is really important. And again, as I mentioned, daughters of the movement, we have our, like, we used to have a monthly call. Now we have like, we have like two Zooms a week. So I think that the sisterhood is extremely important, to have people that you love, that you know love you, have your back, that you can bounce things off of when you're feeling any kinds of challenges. And also, I'm a vegan. You know, health is important. And I especially share with my students that sometimes we don't realize Oreo cookies and McDonald's aren't real food. It is so important, especially during this time when coronavirus came. You know, we had to make sure that our immune system was strong. And so what does that mean? It means don't smoke. Right. Okay. Maybe you can have wine occasionally. Right. But don't smoke, and be conscious of the food that is being marketed as food, and know that it's just a bunch of chemicals that are toxic. And then we find ourselves with these diseases diabetes and all these diseases that are affecting our communities because these foods are marketed to us. Yeah. So, you know, for me, like I said, that's important. You know, yeah. I'm a girly girl.
Thank you so much. We have one more audience member who's coming in. Her name is Tiffany, but she's better known to the world as the Budgetista. We want to talk about the revolution of money.
Ooh. Hi, ladies. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, awesome. This, first of all, it is a privilege. Yes, it's a privilege and a pleasure. So I do have a question. So according to the Road to Zero report published by Prosperity Now and the Institute of Political Studies, the median wealth of Black Americans will fall to zero by 2053 if trends continue. So for decades, we've been told that education is the way, it's the great equalizer, but unfortunately, more education does not automatically equal more wealth for Black households and communities, because the latest results from the Federal Reserve Board survey found that a Black person with a bachelor's degree has a median net worth that is only two-thirds than the median net worth of a white person with no bachelor's degree. So basically, money is flowing through us, not to us. So my question is, what role do you think financial education should play in the fight toward freedom moving forward? I have been teaching financial education to Black women for the last 10 years. I have expanded to start teaching the babies. I wrote a law in New Jersey making financial education mandatory for middle school students, and yet it still feels like it's not enough. What can be done? What role should financial education play for us, and what else can be done?
Well, you know, we are trendsetters everywhere. And there are so many entrepreneurs, right? We're going into our own businesses. I think it's extremely important to understand how our finances work. But I also think education, you know, in addition to financial education, is extremely important. And, you know, education doesn't mean just the education that someone is providing for you. Education is how much information you can discover. Bernice, please.
Huh? You said please?
Were you saying something?
No.
Go ahead. You take it, my love. Yes.
This is what I'm going to say. It's applied education. I think many times people are getting educated, but they are not applying what they are learning. For instance, One of the ways that you build wealth outside of a home, and this is, you know, this may sound a little weird for people, is a lot of the other communities buy life insurance policies on each other. A lot of families came into wealth, believe it or not, through life insurance. And a lot of us don't have life insurance. I don't know why we don't, but I think it's important that people purchase life insurance. The other thing I think, in light of COVID-19, I'm going to say this till probably I'm blue in the face, we have to develop a collective mindset. That means that we have to figure out how not to start my own business, but how can I create cooperatives so that there's a bigger enterprise in the business? Because we got to pool these resources now together like never before. So start an LLC, but start it with 12 people, 15 people, 100 people. You still have your own business, but you have a collective strength. So when things like this happen and you have to get loans, you're in a position to get the loan now because you're not alone, you're with the cooperative, you're with an enterprise. So some of it is, yes, getting the knowledge, educating. We need financial literacy from the time they come out the womb, actually. And then we need to begin to start our kids very early on with their own savings accounts for education and things of that nature, and making wise choices. I mean, I'm from a historically Black college. I want them to survive. I'm concerned about them. But I'm just going to be frank on this conversation. We're in a season now where we have to learn from the real world, corporate world. Sometimes there has to be acquisitions and mergers. we're not going to make it if we continue to dilute our strength by creating one more and one more and one more and one more. We're now at a place that we've got to find out how do we merge our efforts. And it may have to happen with our colleges, our Black colleges. It may have to happen with our Black banks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Uh-oh, Morgan, I think they can't hear you. You're on mute.
I'm here. Yeah, we have three more quick questions in the last one from a baby girl. So we ask people to stay around. Our next one is from an actual genius. She won the MacArthur Genius Award. And she's such a role model to all of us around everything from the environment to doing exactly what you said, which is buying in our communities. From the South Bronx, we'd like to welcome Majora Carter.
Oh, Majora is still
on,
Morgan.
She's out saving the world. That's all right. All right. We're giving her a minute.
That's okay. Yeah, she's going to come on in just a minute. I actually can give us another quick. They're in my ear saying maybe don't give us a quick. We have so many questions that have actually come in from all over the country. Oh, but Majora's on right now. Let's grab Majora. All right. Don't worry, we're getting our Barbara Walters, no, Black Barbara Walters on right now and getting our guests together.
Go ahead and ask the question, Vanessa. Yeah.
Okay. So I have one question that says, what have you been watching? Everybody wants to know, what have you been watching while we've been down on quarantine? What's your favorite show that you've been watching?
I would say for me, I don't really watch television a lot. People have been, you know, talking to me about that, but I don't have any shows. I'm just gonna be honest.
We're gonna pull a list of suggestions together for you.
I do DVR a lot of shows.
You do. What's your favorite one?
I don't know that I have a favorite one, but I do DVR a lot of them, and people are usually surprised that I watch them.
Okay. Well, for everyone out there who's wondering, we actually are pulling together based off last week's conversation, and certainly you guys gave some good stuff. We're going to pull together a Daughters of book list. We definitely are pulling together a Dollars of playlist that's going to have that Negro spiritual and I'm Every Woman, all the songs we suggested. So we're going to have a bunch of different resources for folks so that we can keep this conversation going. And in fact, we do want people to keep the conversation going as our next guest is coming on. Make sure you're using hashtag Daughters of to tell your Daughters of story. In particular, today we are brave. This conversation was brave. Your mothers were brave. You are brave. And we should all go online and post a photo of what we have felt most brave just to honor this conversation. Using hashtag Daughters of will give you that that instruction at the end, because this conversation has just been amazing, amazing, amazing. All right, do we have a next guest on for anyone?
No. Yeah, not yet. Vanessa, while you're just talking about resources, were you about to talk?
Oh, Ilyasah?
Yes, Ilyasah. Or, yeah. No, Ilyasah, I think you were about to say something.
Oh, the only thing I was going to say is that there are so many times when Bernice and I have gotten on the phone, and actually we do Zoom, and she had a birthday, and she had a virtual birthday party of everyone talking and so forth. I didn't acknowledge that we have a really wonderful friendship, and I'm so grateful for it.
Yeah. Oh, so grateful. Thank you for that.
How did that friendship start, though? That's what I want to know. Like, how does the daughter of Malcolm X and the daughter of Martin Luther King, the daughters of Coretta and Betty, how do you become friends? Did y'all call each other up and was like, we're going through the same stuff?
Well, you know, again, we have been misinformed that you had to choose Malcolm or Dr. King and that they were enemies. That is not true. That's a farce. That's a part of this misinformation, the miseducation that creates these ridiculous, divisive tactics, you know, that we're focusing on things that don't even matter. Because yes, of course, my mother and her mother loved one another. I'm so grateful that they found a sisterhood in one another. And Bernice and I can have conversations. And a lot of the things that she shares are things that I feel. And a lot of the things that I share are things that she feels. And so, you know, you discover that you have so much in common.
And it just happens kind of organically. You know, we've been on different platforms together. And you know how sometimes you say, you know, let's connect, and you don't connect. And then you say, let's connect the next time, and you don't connect. Or you say, let's connect the next time, and you do connect. And then you start connecting, and then you start connecting. You know, that's just kind of how it occurred for us.
Awesome.
Yeah, yeah, I want to just make a quick announcement around something that I think is important. If you are out there and you need support, GirlTrek wants to help any woman who might need support. And I just looked at the Facebook feed, and of course, we blew our goal out of the water. 25,000 people have logged on to watch this, and we're so grateful for every single one of you. We're going to close with, I don't know what technical issues are happening. It doesn't even matter because we've had such a rich conversation. We have one last. No, I know. Yeah, I know. I got it. Yeah, no, I know. Okay. I don't know where Majora is, and it's okay. We love you, Majora. Thank you for logging in. We have one last question from, and maybe the most important question from the next generation, from one little girl who'll be coming on. Can we bring her on?
She's coming on right now. She's excited. This is where every movement needs, like, the youth voice. Every movement needs our girls to be inspired. And actually, there are so many women who logged in tonight to watch with their mothers and to watch with their daughters, which is the power of this entire campaign, which is that we can sit down and have this conversation with our mothers and our daughters, which is just really, really beautiful. So, yes. All right. Do we have our last caller?
And while we're waiting for you, can I make a little announcement that on Tuesday, May 19th is my father's birthday, his 95th birthday, and we are planning this entire Malcolm X Day. We have Angela Davis. We have Common. We have many an intergenerational activists and scholars. And the topic is Malcolm X in the 21st century beyond COVID-19 after the chickens came home to roost, which I just thought was really brilliant title. But we have a lot of participants, and we're just so grateful. So we want everyone to also watch Facebook Live, Twitter, Instagram, and so forth to see our programs.
Which Facebook account is it on? Is it on yours, Ilyasah?
Yes, it will be on Ilyasah Shabazz and the Shabazz Center.
Ilyasah Shabazz, okay.
And you might get to see Bernice King one more time.
it's Bryce. All right,
her name is Bryce. To ask your question.
My question is, if your mother, in your opinion, what superhero is your mom?
My mother would be Wonder Woman. Wonder Woman, you know, I would say Wonder Woman because of understanding our ancestry, the rich legacy of the queendom that we inherited, the queenliness of who we are, being bold, being beautiful, being brilliant, carrying all of this forward.
So would my mom.
Oh.
That's beautiful. So is her mom. That's beautiful.
Yes, it is.
So thank you to the both of you for this conversation. It has been so historic, so beautiful. And for all of the thousands of women who have called in tonight, this was a continuation of the energy that Angela and Nikki set, Dr. Angela Davis set for us, and Nikki Giovanni set for us to come. This, I want people to remember that this is a part of a major campaign, that we don't want you to just tune in. We want you to say the names of your mothers and your mothers and your mothers before them, share their stories tonight. Your mothers were brave. Tell us why they were brave. Your mother, you were brave. Tell us what you learned about your mother about bravery. Share a photo of when you were brave. Use hashtag daughters up. Have somebody and tell them that they needed to be a part of this conversation. And if they missed last week, tonight, here's what you need to know is happening next week, Morgan. What is happening next week? Because we are keeping this conversation and this party and this energy going. We can't stop, won't stop. Shout out to Diddy. We're holding you in our prayers, Diddy, right now. Come on, Morgan, what's next week?
Yeah, so first we started with revolutionaries. Then we started with the Black royal family. Next week we're going all out with sisterhood. I mean sisterhood. I mean every single sorority, every president of every single sorority uniting on this stage. If you are a part of a sorority, come. If you are a part of our sorority, Me Find Me, come. We're gonna talk about sisterhood and we're gonna make a plan to launch the most incredible movement together. So let's talk, let's convene, let's figure it out. Mark your calendars, 7 p.m. Eastern time next Friday, right here. All of the Delta, presidents of the Divine Nine.
Zetas, Sigmas, get your outfits together, get your crews together. Your presidents are about to represent live here for a Daughters of Conversation that is going to be beautiful. So, well, ladies, we hope you too.
There will be a poll to see who has the most members in the audience. It'll be a live poll. So, wear your clothes, wear your outfits. I can't wait to learn about this service tradition in our community. So, thank you so much. Ilyasah, thank you so much for coming with your full heart and your love. Dr. King, thank you so, so much for everything that you gave. I loved our conversation. I'm just grateful that you both are professionals. Glitches, and I appreciate that so much. I feel like it was an honor, and I just wanted to say thanks.
Thank you. All right. So one last thing. We're going to say goodnight.
Yes, we have a surprise. Just goodnight. Yes, we wanted to support Betty Before X, and so we're going to be putting free copies for any little girl who's watching out here on our store. You just use the code hashtag or daughters of, and we'll be able to get that to you. It'll be on our store. No worries. And also we're going to be, there's a Coretta Scott King children's book as well I'm about to embarrass the whole Black community. Tazaka, is that how you say it? Vanessa, help me, rescue me. Yes, and we're going to be giving away those books as well. Yes, yes, I know. Black card revoked. So please, if you're a girl who's watching this today, please go to girltrek.org and go to our store. While supplies last, we're going to be able to give away as many as we can.
And join our community.
Thank you so much.
GirlTrek is going to be a million Black women before the end of 2020. You could take the pledge online. We walk, we inspire each other, we hold each other accountable. This is really, we put the move in movement, literally. So become a part of the community. Thank you so much for this conversation. I'm overwhelmed and overjoyed. And thank you. Just thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks for all who are joining. It was Malcolm X's birthday this month. It was Stevie Wonder's birthday this week. So we're going to go out with just a dance party with Stevie Wonder. Thank you all. See you soon.
Yes. Bloom in early May.